Hi, I'm Derek Mountfield and you're watching Toffee TV.
Welcome to Toffee TV. We're here with Derek Mountfield. Obviously, on Saturday we had the sad passing of Howard Kendall, Everton's most decorated manager, an absolute legend of the club. Anyone who's been around Everton for the last 20, 30, 40 years will have had something to do with Howard Kendall. We've got a top man here to tell us all about him. We don't really want to be morbid about this. Derek's going to tell us those stories that you just won't be able to hear anywhere else. We shouldn't really say money here, to be honest. But Degs, when did you first encounter Howard Kendall?
Personally, via a phone call. I was at Tranmere Rovers the summer of 1982. Bags packed, end of season trip planned with Tranmere. Training on the far side of the pitch. And when I say a season trip, I don't mean Magaluf. It was Blackpool.
Yeah.
Two nights in Blackpool was going to be. And we're training, and Brian Hamilton rang me and shouted, "Come over, I want to talk to you." And he went, "I think they're selling you. I had an offer from somebody." I went, "Who is it?" He went, "Everton." And I couldn't get the phone quick enough. On the other end of the phone was Howard Kendall. "Hi, son, we've had you looked at. Yeah, we think you got a little bit of a chance." And he said, "Can you play in this game next week?" I went, "Yeah." He went, "Do you know where Belfield is?" I went, "Of course I do. I spent hours on my bike cycling there to get autographs as a kid, so I know where Belfield is." So he says, "Can you be there on Tuesday night at 4 o'clock? Okay, so I turn up at 4 o'clock. First time in life I got through the gates. The green gates of Belfield.
Yeah.
And I walk in and Howard says, "Welcome, mate, come upstairs, up you come." And I walk in and there's Lyons and there's Higgins and there's McMahon and there's all, I'm going, "What the hell am I doing here?" So we then went to Preston, played the game at Preston where I entered leave my boots on the bus before the game, and another story there. But after the game, I think we got beat 3-1, I think, in a testimonial match, and I'm coming back on the bus. He calls me over, sit down in front of the bus, and he's got a glass of wine like usual, and he says, well done, lad, quite impressed tonight," he said. "How do you think?" I said, "Well, you know, tried. Yeah, we'll be in touch. Don't worry, so we'll be in touch." So off I went home. Get home, and I'm waiting for that phone call. "We'll be in touch." That means, hopefully, I've done really well tomorrow morning. And I must have sat by the phone downstairs the best part of a week. And it rang. "Hello? Mum, it's for you." "Hello? Oh, it's for you." And eventually, I'd been training and went upstairs, three-story house. Phone goes, Mum shouts, "Derek, it's for you." And I must have 40 steps in 5 little seconds. Boom, boom, boom. Down about 4 strides. "Who is it, Mum?" She went, "Howard Kendall, who's he?" So, took the phone, of course. "Yeah, we like what we've seen, son. Can you come over to Belfield for a medical?" So I turned at Belfield. Doctor said, "Cough." He said, "Yeah, you're fine, lad." off to Goodison. And the rest is history. I signed for Everton. And I said to people now, you could give me a blank contract and said you owe Everton £200 a week to play for us, I would have signed it. But Howard, you know, I'll always be eternally grateful for the fella. He saw something in this young, skinny little lad from Tranmere Rovers who he thought could maybe make a chance in the top flight. And he gave me the chance to not only sign for the team I support him like, but to actually be part of that great, great era. And on that score, I'll be ever eternally grateful for him, because I, to this day, will always play myself down, never thought I was a great footballer. But he gave me that one chance. And you don't get that chance all the time in your life. And I'd like to thank him for that. And I think I took that chance as well.
What was he like as a manager? Because obviously that was when you signed you, Everton, when
the best
team in the world.
No,
but we went on to suddenly become maybe the best team in the world.
Probably all down to me. Not. I used a scenario of, I've been at Tranmere for 3.5 years. And pre-season was first day back, Sandhills. Up and down Leeso Sandhills in the morning. Afternoon, running around the Bevington Oval, doing lap after lap after lap. So I spent 4 weeks when I signed for Everton, because I'd signed, went away with the U team to Groningen with Gary Stevens, Kedrich and all those lads. And I trained my backside off. I went to the Sandhills on my own, went down the beach, I went round the track, and I came in first day for pre-season. I'm thinking, I hope I'm fit enough. I might be back of the group here. Hated long runs. And then the ball came out first day. What's this? And we spent the first 4 days doing no more than 30, 40 yard runs with balls as part of the fitness regime, all to a clock, all to scores.
Yeah.
And the losing team had to do a forfeit. And then the afternoon, it was one team did a 20 minute run, one did head tennis, which he absolutely loved,
yeah,
and one did circle work. So I'm thinking, this is not what I'm expecting. For me, he was so ahead of the time in what I'd seen at Tranmere Rovers with his attitude and his look out at the game. And everyone will say what we did at Everton was phenomenal, but his forward thinking was brilliant. He did things differently to what I'd experienced. Yeah, I'd gone from fourth division to first division, but the whole thing was different for me. And I just opened my eyes to how good football could be and how enjoyable it was at the club.
What was it like? Because obviously you've know that you just stand on the Gwlady Street. So what was it like going from the Gwlady Street, you know, the terraces? Obviously you've been to Tranmere Rovers and stuff, but being on the terraces 1 minute and then being part of the team you were watching.
Well, I left school in summer of 79. The summer of 82, I'm signing for Everton. In the summer of 84, and we're in the FA Cup. I can't put into words what it meant, because I just can't believe that this young, skinny centre-half of 6'2" went from being a school kid at 16, 79, to winning the FA Cup at 21. And I was just absolutely gobsmacked the way my career developed in such a short space of time. And you'll always talk about that great Everton team, and a lot of the lads will always mention one man. Without Mark Higgins' unfortunate injury, might never have been at Derek Mountfield. Because I took Mark's place, and when I got into the team, we went on to great things. But if Mark had been fit, I might never have played for the club. It might have been Mark and Kevin. And I'll always say to people, without Mark's unfortunate injury, I might never have got the chance. But when you get your chance in any walk of life, you've got to try and grab it. And Howard gave me that chance, and I'd like to think I took a good grab of it.
When you see, when we look back at 84, and we see the image of you all on the steps, Bats has got the cup, and then it always goes to Howard Kendall, that look of pride on it. I mean, you see some managers now and they go over the top or they hold it in, and it's like this too cool to school sort of thing. But hit that face on that day, the pride he had in that team that he'd taken, because a lot of his were quite young, come out of Colin Harvey's youth team as well. So, you know, the pride was amazing.
I think the way we kicked off that second half of that 8:34 season at Christmas time, with that rubbish game against Coventry and all those, Birmingham away, we get a victory and we go on a little bit of a run. And then the Stoke game and the FA Cup, when there must have been 10,000 people at Stoke, and went in there and he just opened the window and says, "Boys, you can't let them lads down out there." And the noise was bang, banging around the changing room.
Was it?
Oh, it was immense. 2-0 victory and we get through, and then everyone talked about the Oxford game. But I think getting to the Milk Cup final against Liverpool and playing so well at Wembley when we really should have won the game, I think Howard got a massive belief in the lads. And getting to Wembley was the icing on the cake for him. And you see the pitch, and he looks like he's on top of the world. Yeah. We were on top of the world.
Yeah.
But he looked like, "Oh, my lads, look at them." And I know for a fact that we all got 11 or 12 of us got our medals. Howard got his winner's medal about 4 years ago off the FA. But they didn't get it to the managers. So I'm pleased he got that.
It was
20 years down the line, but he got his winner's medal given to him by the FA, you know, 20 years later on. But that picture is iconic from Wembley that day. He just looks absolutely over the moon for the lads.
Like and himself. Proud father.
Oh, he was lovely,
That's my favourite picture, to be honest with you.
Now, obviously, we're talking about the young players coming through, but what do you think was his best skill? Because obviously, he was good at picking people up like Peter Reid, who people have forgotten about, Andy Gray, people thought were on the scrap heap. What does that show about him as a manager?
I think he identified that we need a little bit more grit, a little bit more of experience in the camp. You know, we had Trevor Stephen, younger than me, we had Gary Stevens, my age, we had, you know, Ratty was a youngster, Sharpie was only about 23, 24. You know, so there was a lot of young kids in the side, and he realised we needed a little bit more get in there and get stuck in. Andy had won things in the past, and really was an honest, gritty, determined player. They came in as winners. They came in and lifted us and got us off the floor. Ever talks about the Coventry game early on that season when, you know, really came on. We came out from 1-1, 2-1, and it was the League Cup.
Yeah.
I wasn't the side at the time then, but they were winners. But he had an eye for other players. Look at Trevor Stephen. Look at Kevin Sheedy. Look at Alan Harper. You know, look at Adrian Heath. Look at Sharp. Oh, Sharpie came before him, but he was had an eye of picking up players. Van der Nau, Paul Bracewell. These players he picked up who other managers probably wouldn't have touched, but he had that skill to blend them into a team of players by doing things Howard Kendall's way, which was great team spirit, great collective togetherness, Chinese meals once, twice, three times a season, all the fines, you know, away trips, putting no pressure on away trips to be in bed at this time or bed at that time. No. Treat it like kids, like adults. Some managed to treat it like kids and do this, do that. But it was that belief in the camp, and that belief came from Colin Harvey being with him and Mickey Heaton being with him. Yeah. And it transgressed into what was one hell of a good team spirit in the camp. And that means a hell of a lot to any team in football or in cricket or in golf and tennis or rugby, whatever it is. You need that team spirit to be together, and we were.
And he wasn't afraid. I mean, remember we bought Mickey Thomas and he wasn't afraid to go,
no.
Yeah, this isn't worked out after 11 games, and off he went. And Steve McMahon, I mean, you know what? I'm going to ask you something that you didn't know anything about, no, but I want you to tell me. What happened with McMahon? Because he was in our midfield and he was a bright young thing. So a little, we used to call him a bit of a poser at that time because he used to love flicking that blonde hair that he lost.
Like this fella.
Bit like him, yeah. But he seemed to be, you know, Steve McMahon was in our side and people
maybe
liked him.
Maybe Howard decided, not for me.
Yeah.
You know, Howard was a very good judge of a player until he saw me.
I don't think you don't see
that. Yeah, I'm going to say, yeah. You know what?
I just look at the players. I think when he first came to the club, he brought the Magnificent Seven.
Yeah.
Of which only really Neville Southall made any form of Everton career.
But he could make up for the other six.
Yeah. Mick Walsh, Alan Barley, Mickey T, Alan Ainscoe, Jim Arnold. Jim was a great keeper as well. But, you know, we bought this seven in. Everyone thought, wow, that's it. The Magnificent Seven come in. And it was, oh, my. Oh, well. Yeah. And I think I was there that second season. I came in the summer of the second season. And I'm there. And I had the experience of, wasn't in the first team, but I trained with the Irvines, the Fergusons, the Barleys, twice a week in the afternoon. He'd bring them back with guys. Colin, get them all back in, get the kids with them. And I was training with these. That for me was a massive learning curve.
Yeah.
Howard saw that. And I look at some of the players he brought in. Yeah, no manager's perfect with the signings. They always make boo-boos and messes up. But in the end, what he had a collective 13 or 14 players that I think were probably the best group of players. Very closely followed by the lads out of Carlisle, when I was at Carlisle for a season, where we were together. We were one massive big unit. And if someone kicked you, one of us would get the lad who kicked you back.
Yeah.
You know, if someone kicked Reedy, Ratty would go and get him later on. If someone elbowed Sharpie, Andy Gray would come and get him afterwards.
I mean,
you know, we looked after each other.
The biggest thing with that was when Inchy got done by Marwood.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Inchy's been done with it at a time when he was on fire.
Inchy was flying then.
He was the best striker in the land at that time. He scored 13 goals up until December the 1st, I think it was, or something like that.
And he was on fire.
Anyway, and he gets done by Marwood, and then 10 minutes later, right below, I'm sat in the Bullens with my dad, right below me, he puts Marwood into the paddock and just says, yeah, get on with it.
Yeah, you can't do that now, though. You can't do that now, but we looked after each other. You know, we talked, we probably know when I mentioned the Bayern Munich game, but Andy Gray must have pushed Argentara's nose into his face, out of his face, and back in again about four times. Because once, and really put the sponge down his shin and still carried on kicking people.
Yeah.
That's what it was. We had that belief we were working as one massive big team. And it helped by Howard saying, look, boys, Chinese meals, you're late for training, 20 quid fine.
Yeah.
You've been sent off, 100 quid fine, all in the kitty. Front Monday morning, right, boys, tomorrow, boys, training in the morning, Southport, Chinese. Or would everyone go there?
Everyone.
And it would be a massive big spread of food. All Chinese food, bottles of wine, pints of lager. At the bottom of the table, fish and chips were never south or not up the team. But he was still there. And we had laughs and jokes. We took the mic out of each other. We talked, we threw food. But that's what it was. It was one big togetherness. Yeah, Howard at times could be the most ruthless man in the world. If you weren't doing it, he'd rip you apart. He'd shout you, bang you, send you off there. But when it was working, it worked very, very well for us. And it's all credit to him. He developed that lovely team spirit.
Made massive decisions as well, though, didn't he? I'm thinking.
Yeah, signing Dave Watson.
Well, I was going to say, first of all, signing Gary Lineker.
He just won
the title and everything. Yeah. But just before Lineker, that summer, I've asked you this before, I don't know where it's gone. But that summer when you came back after we won the FA Cup, did you have any inkling we were about to be? Because Liverpool were European champions and league winners.
Oh, yeah.
Did you have an inkling we were about to go from seventh to first?
No. I remember I got in the first team that season, the 33-34, and we were like 17th, and we were really struggling. finished seventh was great. Yeah. Win the FA Cup was the bonus. Winning Europe, and that to me was massive. Just to play in European football was brilliant. But we came in pre-season, it was all running smoothly, and then we turned up against Tottenham and we're 4-1 down. We lose 4-1. We go to West Brom and we've got 6 goals against and 2 in the first 2 games at the bottom of the table.
Yeah.
I never saw what was going to come. But, you know, Howard never changed his philosophy. Yeah. Do this, do that, keep the meals going out, go out and have a drink on a Saturday night, boys, don't worry about it. And he never changed it. And, you know, we believed in what we had in the camp. We believed that we had the potential to be a great side. And all it needed was something to happen. We got our run of games, bum, bum, bum. And within, we'd always say, Andy Gray says, and really, winning that first one, the FA Cup, was probably his proudest achievement. I think because it's the first one's the hardest one to win. Mm. The rest become easy because you're winners. Once you're a winner, you can become a winner again, but becoming the winner for the first time, I think that was probably one of his proudest achievements, making us into winners, because he saw something in us that could take us on. But in that summer of 84, he still bought Paul Bracewell.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he soon got rid of John Bain and bought Pat Mandanell. Yeah, so he saw weaknesses and saw strengths in people. And he's like, sorry, bum, 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 bum. He's not afraid to do it.
Managers nowadays wouldn't, but they did see that winning team and go, oh, this team's brilliant.
Yeah. What I was going to say is that sort of like, I know you had your injury problem more than anything else, but it was that the same with you. It was like you've got too many injuries. We're gonna go and get the potentially one of the best centre backs in the land.
To be honest, Ben, I was fully fit when he signed Dave Watson. But he made a decision that long term, he saw me as possibly an injury prone and not playing a lot of games.
Yeah.
So he brought in Dave, even when I got in the side and played well, and we were getting the side, we played down at Southampton, and we won 3. No, Dave played 3 at the back, me, Rats and Kevin. Dave went off for the hamstring, and I played the next 9 games with Rats, and we won, I think it was 7, yeah. Drew 1, lost 1, played away at Man City, won 3-1. Next week, Norwich at home, said, my son, you're not playing. Bringing Dave back, he's fully fit now. And I'm thinking, you know, I've just played 9 games, really good well. You said I was going to play Saturday after the full Members' Cup game midweek. And he went, oh, I'm not dropping it. And that was it. For them, that was my Everton career, really, on a hold. He could be ruthless.
Mm.
So I can say, yeah, he gave him a chance, but he also stopped me playing for Everton. We brought Dave Watson in. But, you know, I'll never really hammer him because he gave me the chance to play for the team I love. You know, I'm sitting here now talking about playing for Everton, winning trophies. Yeah. And, you know, he gave me that chance. Yeah, but he was ruthless. He could be ruthless. Mm-hmm. Andy Ray getting sold.
I mean, that was
ruthless. We're all going, whoa, what's going on here? You know, no, off he goes. Don't need you. You know, he could be like that. He could be ruthless. And that's the sign of a top-class manager. Mm-hmm. You've got to have your good side, your fatherly side, arm around the shoulder, pick people up, but also be ruthless at times. And he could be very, very ruthless.
Obviously, he went to Spain. Wasn't much left here to do, to be honest. I mean, he could have won us a few more leagues, I suppose.
I think once the European ban came in, I think Everton lost a lot of the players due to it. Trevor and Gary went to Rangers, Howard went away, and I think that was the start of the breakup of that team that should have gone, or that squad should have gone on for years and years and years to not only be top in English football, but probably the top of European football for many years. It was taken away, and Howard wanted, after having one season of European football, he wanted to try a bit more of it. And you can't fault him for doing it.
And the wine's nicer in Spain.
I believe it is.
Yeah, so that probably might have had something to do with it. But obviously, you come back to Everton, two unsuccessful spells, really. I mean, I don't know what if you can say the third one was successful. It was a terrible team, really, and it kept us in the league. So
I think the second spell, was we were okay in the second spell. I think the board let him down. Because
if you look at the second spell, you know, he allegedly went over Dion Dublin not being signed, and Mick Walker came in. And then Mick went and Joe came in. So how many players did Mick actually buy?
Well, not many.
So that team that Joe inherited was probably a lot of Howard's team. Mm. And people forget about that.
Yeah, yeah.
Howard got that team going back in the second spell. Yeah. Got sacked. Mick Walker came in. Shouldn't have come in.
Joe Parkinson, Anders Limpar. Yeah. That was it, really.
But that team that Joe Rawl inherited was probably Howard's. And people don't realise that. So Howard started that redevelopment for Joe 2 years down the line. So again, he saw potential and saw people.
Even like in the States, people like Don Hutchinson, the way they talk, you know, they talk about him saying, Duncan Ferguson, you know, I idolised him. You know, he was his mentor as well when he started his coaching his career. You know, I remember seeing him at a Q&A session and he'd just come with Kevin Sheedy because he was his mentor. Duncan used to go around to his house and get advice off him and things like that, and he idolised him. So just from that point of view, that saddens me that in a little bit, because it's sad that over the last few years he didn't have a role at the club. And we spoke about on one of our other videos with Joe Royal and what he does at the club now, and it's sad that Howard hasn't had a role for the last 10 years at the club, just overseeing, looking after people.
Howard should be our ambassador. Should have been for 10 years being the top man, going away with all the clubs and being there with his Everton badge on. He'd have loved it. He'd absolutely loved doing all that, because he loves Everton. He loved the club to the core. He was there every single week without fail, and people loved him. You see him walking down, you can't walk down the road without getting mobbed by people. He's got such iconic status at the club. And he should have been used by the club more, but happens a lot in football. They don't use the past particularly well.
On that, obviously Roberto Martinez welcomed him into the club when he came. But do you think David Moyes let him down in that side of things?
I don't know whether it's let him down, but David Moyes chose not to really engage with the past of the club, with the former players in that decade, that era. I don't know David Moyes particularly well. I don't think Howard did. For Howard and Everton to have Finch Farm for 8 or 9 years and then not be invited to have a tour of the place until Roberto Martinez comes in, just shows you what sort of attitude David Moyes had towards those glorious days of the 80s. I think sometimes...
You're terrified.
I think we were a millstone around his neck at times, because everyone talked about the great 80s side, and David Moyes didn't like it because he's trying to build a team with the 2000s. But sometimes you've got to embrace the past to move to the future. Yeah. And I don't think David Moyes embraced the past history of the club, especially the past players of the club, as well as he could have done.
Do you think that though should have been taken out of his hands? Maybe someone at the club should have stood up and said, Howard Kendall deserves to have a place at this club.
I don't know.
We see, you don't have to walk. You mentioned there, I've seen him most games walking down Goodison Road, people stopping him. It was a little bit, I feel a little bit bad and a little bit ashamed, because I used to just treat it.
It becomes like habit. It's your routine. You see him all the time.
And now he's past, you think, greatest ever manager.
My last time I met him was last first game of the season. I went to the Watford game, only going to beat you this season, and went into the number 9's Ray Parr's house. There he is in his gaffer's chair. All right, how are you, mate? Come here. I made a shake hand, tinkle the glass, and we had a glass together.
Yeah.
And that's the last time I saw him. But I'll always remember Howard as sitting there. And I remember one time, this is a bit of a drinking story here. I took Dave Ixon, who became a very good friend of mine, to one of the Echo Awards dinners. And I met his wife, and we got over there. And they went, where are you sitting, Dave? I don't know. So you're sitting there with Howard. I'm on that table over there. And Howard never used to let his wine glass get empty. Davison sitting there and glass of wine and have a little sip, and Howard would do this and do Dave's, and Dave's doing this, thinking, oh, that glass didn't go down, are you? Dave couldn't stand up end of the night. He thought he'd had one glass of wine, and Howard just kept topping his glass up, and Dave was absolutely out the, and Howard was the same, but Dave didn't realise. I thought, oh, that's a long glass of wine I've had, but Howard kept topping it up, and Dave didn't see it, but Howard loved his drink, but as I said, those stories of Dave getting absolutely leathered by Howard and not even realised it. I'd always remember that one, because Dave literally couldn't stand up.
You mentioned the drinking. We can't talk about Howard Kendall without...
He loved it.
Listen, my brother-in-law got pictures of him last week in town, last Saturday night. That's why it came such a shock to me. There's pictures of him I believe he was with Everton on Friday doing a video with them, and someone actually said to him, you don't look too well,
It's one of them, Howard could control his drink, but when he got on it, he loved it, and it was a social tool for him, and he'd sit and talk. And I remember going to a dinner with Alan Ball once, and it was a golf day, and someone asked Alan Ball a question, and the place went quiet, and everyone goes like that, and Ball, he hold court. Howard was the same. Ask him a question, glass of wine would go down, and he'd sit there holding court. And the room would just go silent. Bawley was superb at it. And the Holy Trinity, is slowly but surely being taken away. And I'm sure those who are up there now with a glass of red wine reminisced about the good days and the things that have gone on. Because there were two fantastic footballers and two pretty decent managers as well. So they're probably sitting there having a good laugh and joke with each other. But, when the question came to Howard, the place went quiet. Especially number 9s, it went quiet. And the whole stories were reminiscing out, and if you talk, shut up, please, shut up. You know, and sometimes it got a bit offensive when if you get talking over him, but he wanted to hold court. He wanted to be the main man. And some of his stories are phenomenal.
Graham Taylor. I mean, he should have got the job when Graham Taylor got it. Graham Taylor had done literally nothing in English football.
The rumour is that he was asked, did he want to go down for an interview? And he said, no, I don't. I was with Graham Taylor at Villa when we finished second to Liverpool in 1990. And he was probably, like England do, we go for the most successful manager at the time in English football. And Graham got the job and really struggled because Graham is a man manager. Graham wants with the players 24/7. Brilliant at it. With the media in our country, would it have suited Howard being an England manager? With the digging and the dirt and the scandal. I don't think it would have suited him. And I think he made a conscious decision himself that, no, I don't want the job. Bit like Brian Clough.
Yeah.
At the time, probably the best person for the job. But the FA will always take the safer option rather than the best option. And I just think maybe the media scrutiny might be a bit too much for him.
I think he would have.
But he would have been, probably would have been a great manager, just like Brian Clough would have been.
Yeah.
He would have been the perfect England manager. And sometimes we, as our country, we don't make the best decision when it comes to our managers.
What would you like to see now from the club? I mean, obviously, Saturday was sad because it was all too fast.
It was not
the club didn't really stand the chance, did they, with it all? It just happened so fast. And I never felt like it, you know, it almost felt like it just happened too fast. Yeah. I mean, there's, you know, people petitions now for Holy Trinity statues and renaming of stands. I mean,
the thing is, I don't want the fans to go, oh, we made him change the name of the stands. They've probably got that in hand now, Evan. They're probably thinking, what can we do to recognise
it? Yeah.
It might be the stand, it might be a statue.
Yeah.
But the fans will try and take some of the glory, saying, oh, our petition got on this. But no, the club will obviously be thinking about it. Dave Hickson had the lounge, the sponsor named after him not long before he died. You know, Brian LeBowen's got a thing. Howard's got to have something done. Whether it's a statue or the renaming of a stand, I don't know. But he needs something doing at the ground to remember. Because you don't get a player that wins league titles for the club and then goes on to manage into league titles and European trophies. It's happened. It hasn't happened, it won't happen again for a long time. It's happened once, and that man was the main reason it happened.
Last Englishman to win a European trophy?
Yes, I believe he is, yeah. But the club needs to do something. Don't let them rush it.
No.
They've got to speak to the family, etc., because it don't upset the family doing things too quickly. And I think in the long run, the club will do something to honour the man, because he deserves it.
Yeah.
He is the best manager we've had in this club for probably forever. I think I'm not saying against Harry Catrick, but this fella took us to European trophies, and for 4 years we were the best team around, and we should have gone on to bigger and better things.
Yeah, at the time when Liverpool were the best, they overtook.
You know, you said that perfectly. You said the other day, Baz put a tweet out saying, you know, if anyone wants to know what he did, because it was before the Premier League, and it always gets forgotten, but he went head to head with the best team in Europe and beat them.
Yeah, United might take some of the credit over the last 25 years, but he did it in the 80s when it was a lot harder, I think.
Definitely.
You know, and we battled toe-to-toe with them for 4 years. And we had some epic battles, some epic games. And he was crucial to all of that. He will be very sadly missed by a lot of people. And I just hope that the club do something right to recognise him. Because he does deserve it. Yeah, I had my fallouts with Howard. And, you know, we had some good times, we had some bad times. But for what he did for the club in that glorious 4 years, he needs recognising for it.
Personally, I hope it's a statue, personally, or for the Holy Trinity. Baz,
I think it'll be the stand, personally.
Yeah. I think a statue would be nice, but I don't know where. I think the three of them. And the stand,
both of them.
I'd like, yeah.
I just saw pictures of Colin Harvey on Saturday, and he looked distraught.
Yeah, broken.
He was a phenomenal footballer. For me, the best coach I've worked with. And I just hope that Colin, you know, is able to take it on board and realise that, you know, one of my mates has gone now and we see Colin around for a lot longer.
And they're going to need the cathedral, I think.
Westminster?
Possibly.
I don't know. We were talking about before someone, they had Dave Hickson, Gordon West, Barlow Bones at the cathedral, three true legends of the club. He deserves it. But the family might say, no, I want something quiet. It's a family choice.
Yeah, definitely.
And we've got to leave it to the family, but the club will do something in due time. to recognise someone who was not only a great footballer but a fantastic manager and took the club to where we never expected to be. And you enjoyed it. I love playing in it. I just wish we could get there again because I'm sick of being top part of the best Everton team. Let me be part of the second best Everton team because it means we've got to win and do more things.
Thank you. I mean, yeah, just from a fan's point of view, he was just phenomenal. You know, what he gave us, gave me my best days as an Evertonian. And obviously he's going to be sadly missed. And it's horrible because that's where, as a child, and you start watching him and all them memories of fantasy, right. Him as the man, and then to think bit of that's gone, it's horrendous. But it happens, unfortunately, and like Derek said, hopefully, you know, a new manager will come along and give us those great Roberto Martinez.
Maybe so. Tell us what you think in your comments. Leave your messages about Howard Kendall. Tell us some about your experience with them as well on Twitter. It's at TopPTV1. And thanks for joining us. Thanks for Degsy for being here, telling us some of his brilliant stories about Howard Kendall. We'll see you soon.